Thank you so much, Dr. Ranjit, for inviting me for this conference. And entire IASR team, I can see in a brochure, like a lot of people are working to, make this event. The workshop is wonderful. And additionally, this conference, the way it has been organized every month, I can get updates every month. It's really great initiative. And this is things I'm going to discuss today because I feel that a lot of opportunities in the forensic science, and people has to understand where the scope in the forensic science, where are the different disciplines which can be hooked up with the forensic science, and if we can give them opportunity to the all students, and definitely they can do it. So thank you so much to entire IASR team. Thank you so much to chairperson of this particular conference. First, let me share my slide. So today I'm going to talk about solving crimes through the forensic chemistry. I am a hardcore, very experienced nanochemist, but the intervention of nanochemistry in the forensic science is my interest from when I was doing PhD at that time, because the Department of Forensic Science is very close to the chemistry department. And at that time, I felt that the forensic chemistry is not just like it's a new discipline. Forensic chemistry is something which is analytical chemistry, which is integrated with the with the forensic science to help to trace the trace evidences. So first we can understand, like, because I heard that in the brochure the a diverse range of students are there in this meeting, from UG to the research student and maybe the experienced scientist also in this meeting. So today, my entire session, which I'm going to take for half an hour, that is, I've divided into two different sections. First, I will start with some to understand what is this forensic chemistry, so all UG students can understand, they can understand how they can connect with this forensic chemistry. And then slowly I will go towards what I have done, small work which I have also done towards this forensic chemistry, and what are advancement we did gradually, and then what are the opportunities also in this forensic chemistry. So how we can understand this forensic chemistry? It's just like analytical chemistry. Now normally we see in the chemistry has the four disciplines: analytical chemistry, organic chemistry, inorganic chemistry, and feel like inorganic chemistry. But this is the field where a lot of analytical chemistry utilized as for the forensic in forensic science, I would say. So this is the analysis which we do against the law, against the law scene, because once it we if we understand the job of the forensic chemistry is to look the evidence which is given to them from against the law scene when it happened. So forensic chemistry normally deal with qualitative and a quantitative analysis of range of styles, maybe to physical, more towards the physical proof. A lot of experimental investigation is important in the forensic chemistry. So that way we can understand it, just analytical chemistry which apply for this forensic chemistry. So if you look at how this analytical chemistry can help into the to toxicology. So like you can check the effect of poisons, you can monitor the drug adulteration, you can say like drug toxicity you can measure through the analytical chemistry. That call it is a forensic toxicology. Analytical chemistry, if you apply in arson, like investigating the crime of setting fire in a property-based cause and burning a specimen if you take it. So if you apply your analytical chemistry to in arson, that call this arsenic, forensic arsenic. And then analytical chemistry in a drug analysis, we know illicit drugs have caused more than 750,000 deaths in a year. So that also we can apply this analytical chemistry in a drug analysis, that also as a part of illicit drug monitoring. And then if we apply this analytical chemistry in a trace evidence, like glass, fiber, paint, chip, gunshot residue, soil, body fluids, and hair. So that is, that also we can apply in analytical chemistry in a trace evidence identifications. How traditionally and how currently this analysis is happening? Like there are three categories, category A, category B, and category C. You can also divide in a qualitative and a quantitative analysis. Category C is a more a qualitative analysis. Initially, if anybody, any evidence you are getting from the crime scenes, we start with some primary investigation, like color taste and spot testing, and like maybe the small like paper-based testing, you can do it. And if we want robust results and robust accurate detection, then we go through the category B and category A. So if you can see that this large heavy instrumentation is utilized for analysis, and like what forensic chemist can do it, and like if you see what forensic chemist can do, how they can contribute, like if those who are forensic enthusiastic students, how this forensic chemistry job they can done, so they can determine if the, you know, such as accelerant such as gasoline and kerosene was used, if so can this such as that fine fire was intentionally set, so the reasons of this fire at that scene, that can be, they can determine, can also the narrow down the suspect list, people who would have excess substance used in the crime, like just like explosives. They can also detect specific poisons and give detective an idea to what look and what they're interviewing potential suspects. They can help to confirm and refute investigators suspicious in drug and alcohol in cases. And maybe they can also determine the suspected overdose cases, like just like illicit drug monitoring. So this is the job of forensic chemists. They can do it. What are the challenges? Then let's talk about this. We are talking about like because the range of the crime has been increased these days. Like we don't know the criminals' behavior, right? Like criminals are doing various kind of which is crimes they do, and it's sometimes difficult to identify, because I feel that the forensic science is a puzzle, right? Like they have to play with the puzzle, because they do not know what is the nature of the samples, right? And that's most tedious and I would say ultimate issue, like in any forensic student work with the forensic science. So that is the most important challenge, to do not know the nature of the samples. And how another challenge will comes along with it is the contamination issues, right? Many of the samples which are now, many of the samples which are highly vaporized substance, and if we see that it is difficult to collect those samples. So first important and most important challenge, which I feel that it is do not know the nature of the samples. Another is that like if we do not know the nature of the samples, then how we go ahead with it? We normally go with the instrumental technique and the spot testing. And if we check the instrumental technique, then most instrumental techniques are accurate, but they are bulky, very expensive, time consuming. Of course, required when professionals are required, and of course the spot testing. So there are two ways normally we do the analysis of this evidences, like instrumental and the spot testing. And like a lot of instrumental technique have been evolved, like from I saw you in that my last slide, a lot of spectroscopy has been evolved and people are using spectroscopy and microscopy techniques. But if you can see that those are accurate, of course, but they are very bulky, expensive. Like to taking the samples to the laboratory, and then the analysis, the maintenance is very high. If they have an instrument in the maintenance, required very high trained of professionals. But another way is the spot testing, which will normally help in the primary examination, but actually not explore for the accurate detections. So that's more important challenge, and this is the area where not much research has been explored. And this is the area which I'm going to talk about. Before go to the instrumental analysis, I think a lot of research is required at spot testing, because when we do any analysis, what happens is that we start with the qualitative analysis and then with the quantitative analysis, and then with the do the profiling and the end of the when we want to compare those data, we need some profiling. And to, if we can do, this is the challenges, because when we do the instrumental analysis, either with the spot testing, but especially when we do the instrumental analysis and when we take the samples to the laboratory, challenges are like a lot of challenges, if you can say, environmental challenges, cross-contamination, sample collection itself one bigger issue, because some high vaporized samples are easily get vaporized. Is it not easy to collect? Stress level detection is also tampering with evidences, because if we don't do the analysis immediately, it may have a chances that The criminals can be scot free because of they do not have samples to detect. So these are the challenges. So how we can overcome those challenges, and what are the scope in a forensic chemistry, I would say. So we can come up with the new solutions if you want to boost the surveillance. And I feel that there are two different ways, and this is the new different area which we can go into that, and all forensic students can think about it. First one is to identify a new markers and biomarker for those specific detections, whether it is explosive, whether it is poisons, whether it is a toxic metals, drugs, body fluids. Can we identify, can we come with the new markers? Like, we are using chromatographic techniques, we are using microscopic technique, and if we can identify new markers, new molecules, which is very specific and accurate towards those forensic specimen, so that will be helped to make some handheld system, portable system, where we can monitor immediately, not only just detection, also for the sample collections. I know a couple of new technologies can help for the sample collections. So this is the area, and this is the scope. I think forensic students, those who are interested in this area on the chemistry side, that they can do it. Another area is to explore forensic chemistry at atomic level for trace level detections. What happens is that when we do the trace level detection, we do not know how much amount is there, maybe sometime visible, sometime it is invisible. So this is the area which I explored, and I got some success into that. I will tell you some examples later on, but the nanochemistry. So I'm going to talk more about this nanochemistry. Okay, so these are so I'm going to talk about this nanochemistry part specifically because we worked on it and we found some interesting results, which I'm going to discuss. We identify few markers which can help for the specific detection of some drug monitoring. So before that, I just want to tell you how this is going to benefit it, because if you use this nanotechnology and forensic science, because nanotechnology is extensively used for the biological applications, mathematics, chemistry, engineering, and the physics, and a lot of smart technologies which is actually helping to the society. And of course, forensic science also, it's not a separate discipline. It is also a merger of biology, maths, chemistry, and law and physics, and which is science related to the code. So if we can mix together, like, we can create a smart nanotechnological products, which can help with the justice, and can be we can save the time to get this justice. But before that, I don't know how many of you know about this nano. So just I will go through with just a couple of slides. So nano is just atomically precise limited collection of atoms. Normally we know bulky groups have more than 10 by 23 atoms. But if when we convert this bulky materials and bulky group into the nanomaterials, we talk about just few numbers of atom, and that actually in the size of 0.1 nanometer or 1 to 5 nanometer. So this is the range, and this is the scale where we work when we work on the nanomaterials. And if you look at the dimension of those nanomaterials, we work between the 1 to 100 nanometer, and we make the nanomaterial which is in the size of 1 to 100 nanometers. The definition is 1 billionth of something around, which is equal to the 1 nanometer. And interesting part of this nanoparticle is that we can manipulate based on our need. Like, if you want to detect an explosive, if you want to detect any illicit drugs, if you want to detect any other toxic materials, we can manipulate, we can make a chemical composition depend on our need. And the important characteristic of nanoparticle is that we can get different colors of solutions. We can make a different size of nanoparticle, which have a different applications. Maybe this time may be difficult to understand, but you can explore it, how this beautiful properties of those nanoparticle can be helpful in the forensic science. It's just like there's a naked nanoparticles, and we are covering with the different colors of solution, which help into the detection of this forensic specimen. Another important is that you can functionalize, like, based on your need. Like, you can see how people wear different dresses. It's just like you can decorate your nanoparticle, like, because you can also change the material, you can also manipulate the size, you can also change the surface, you can also make different shapes of nanoparticles. So if you tune property, if you tune properly those four different dimensions of nanoparticle, and then that actually will help you to use this nanoparticle in the forensic science, right? This is just very, very So you need to understand in detail a little bit, but this is a brief overview about why this nanoparticle is helpful in the forensic science. That actually I'm trying to make you understand, because you can do the manipulation based on your need, because this is the important characteristic which can be utilized for the forensic science. Let us understand a couple of examples. So this is a review we have published in 2018, nanotechnology in the forensic science. So nanotechnology can be used in the latent fingerprint. It can be used in the biosensor, can be used security features in the documents, DNA fingerprint, and GSR analysis. So we have extensively used those nanoparticles in two different areas, latent fingerprint and the biosensor, and more we have worked on the biosensor because I have worked on years in the biosensors development. So if you look at this biosensors part, I will show you the couple of examples how, and before that we understand how it works, because many of them may aware about it, those sensing mechanism. So here is the you can consider this analyte is a forensic specimen. Bioreceptor, which I'm talking about, highly specific marker we have to choose, which is against the analyte. We must between analyte and bioreceptor and how we can measure the signals, right? So especially I will show you some example how we tuned it and how we utilize this. So we have used gold and silver nanoparticles extensively, because gold and silver nanoparticles actually have a colorimetric change properties. We have targeted toxic ions, we have targeted body fluids. So I will show you just examples, like this is the color of gold nanoparticles. And when we add after the functionalization on those gold nanoparticles, and we add for any forensic analyte, it gives the color change like red to blue. So this is the property which we are using for the forensic chemistry and as a forensic nanochemistry as well. And this is another nanoparticle, silver nanoparticle, when we add any body fluids and when we add any biofluid into this or any forensic specimen, it gives the color change from yellow to red. So this is the property which we normally are using it for development of biosensors, development of forensic sensors. I will show you a couple of examples. This work which I published in 2014, we have made curcumin nanoparticles, and we found that by some binding studies, the curcumin has high affinity towards the explosive. So what we do is that we made a curcumin nanoparticle and we use this explosive material TNT, and we have modified curcumin nanoparticles, and we interacted with the explosive. We found good color change, significant color change we observed. So this curcumin nanoparticle initially was in a red, yellow in color, and when we added explosive into that, we found a significant color change from yellow to red. This paper you can find in Google it, so you'll find this paper, and it's published in very good international journal. And we also compared this this TNT with this close other explosives like RDX and other DTN as well. So we found that it has very specific affinity towards the curcumin. So that's how, like, curcumin is our new marker, you can say, new molecule which we identify can be helpful the explosive. But again, this is we have done on a laboratory scale. It needs to be scale up. Another example which I want to tell you is that sedative drug detections. So this is the gold nanoparticle which we synthesize, and we identify one specific molecules, which is nitrogen containing ligand molecule, because we know this nitrogen containing chemistry, it is helpful to detect the sedative drugs. So what we do is that this AUNP nanoparticle, we modified this nitrogen containing ligands molecules, and then we added sedative drugs. With what we found interesting results is that colorimetric change. So gold color of gold nanoparticle was red in color, and when we found that after addition of this drug, we found blue color. So this is actually helped to understand the presence of sedative drug. So this is very specific, like this is for the drug which we use is the clonazepam. So clonazepam is a drug which we have utilized, and we found that it only detects the clonazepam, no any other drugs. So, and that work we have already published in 2018. So this kind of interesting results which we are getting. I will tell you some more examples. And this is the melamine modified gold nanoprobes, which we have designed. And this is on-spot colorimetric recognition of clonazepam from biological specimen. So this is the red in color, and when we added this clonazepam, we found blue color. This gives, and this work is already published in Analyst Journal 2013, and we found very interesting results. So detailed studies we have done with some real samples as well. And we found that it can be helped if we can scale up, we can convert, make some optical detection system, can we help to detect trace evidences of this clonazepam. Another interesting work which we have done is a smart and rapid colorimetric system, where we found that the codeine sulfate we have detected. So this is another, again, the same, we have choose gold nanoparticles and we have modified with our new marker. You might be surprised why again we are getting the same color change and why same sort of behavior, but where is the important role in making this sort of nanosensors and this sort of forensic sensors is these markers. Markers you will find different, right? These markers playing very important role, not this gold nanoparticle, because markers are so specific towards those drugs. And that's why we are getting a color change. Not this is the natural property of gold nanoparticles. So, and again, we have integrated because when, if you see it, gold nanoparticles, when we modified the red in color, and when we detected those codeine sulfate, we found color, blue in color. And not only we have just colorimetric detection we did, but we did with the smartphone. We try to little, we went little ahead with the smartphone monitoring, like once you have a sample, then when you have a trace evidences, and we have unknown samples, you just add sample in a, that the solution which will give it to you. And if you immediately get a color change, you can quantify it, how much amount of that drug is present. So we also just attempted, and that work is also published in 2014. Just you will Google it, you will find it. Another we have also work we have done is that this lab on phone based analysis. So in a lab on face detection also we have done, where we have, again we took silver nanoparticle, this time we choose and we use lidocaine hydrochloride, and this gold silver nanoparticle is silver nanoparticle is we modified with some linker and again new markers, and as we add this lidocaine hydrochloride into our silver nanoparticles, we got color change from yellow to red, and that also we monitored through the smartphone. And that's how we try to not only just qualitative analysis, but we also did the quantitative analysis. And this work also been published in Analytical Methods in 2015. So you can see and you can find the detailed studies, and you can also find what is the effect of other drug which is close related to that. So this is again very specific detection towards those drug detection, and maybe it helped. We also did some real sample analysis in skeletal remains. This is the smart platform which is developed by one of our team members, like platform for sensitive determination of cystine and humus vitreous cystine. And you can see we have again made silver nanoparticles, and we have modified with the cystine, and then we found that when this vitreous humor comes in a contact with this modifier, silver nanoparticle modification, we got color change from yellow to red. And we again monitored through the smartphone, and we qualitatively and quantitatively also we have analyzed the amount of cystine present in the vitreous humor. And this work is published in a very high impact journal in 2016. And also we did some real sample analysis, so we can also calculate the time from since death. So this kind of intervention can be that possible when we use this nanoparticle, because this nanoparticle can detect the cystine at very low level. Low level, it means that at nanomolar level. So if you want to detect at very low concentration, and this nanochemistry can be very helpful. Now challenge, like if you see what is the challenges we faced when we are doing this, like we did the synthesis, we did target specific modification, we developed the nanosensor. But here the problem is that we did at solution level, that adaptability was not found because cost was high. Stability, sometimes we found the issues we did at a laboratory level. So we thought, like, why can't we resolve this all problem in a one platform? How we can make a very low cost, can be implementable at laboratory at a point of need. So we then move towards the paper-based analytical device. Why can't we convert this sort of laboratory level sensors into the paper-based analytical device? So again, we microfluidic paper-based detection we started, and for alprazolam detection. So what we did that we have made a paper-based microfluidic devices, and this is the micro pad we have designed. We have wax paper we use to round cut, heat press, and we have added silver nanoparticle. Again, we use the silver nanoparticle. And again, like the silver nanoparticle is not just only naked nanoparticle. We have modified with some markers, specific markers. And as we add this, and then that silver nanoparticle we have fixed in the one cassette which we have developed. And then we added alprazolam into that, and we found color change. Like this is the modified AGNP, and when we added ALP, we found color change here. And then we monitor with our smartphone system, which we have already developed. And this is the quantitative detection, which we did. And this work is also published in Analytical Method in 2017. So this is a little advanced work which we have done. And then we again do like how we did the smartphone analysis, like we check the grayscale intensity of dot spot which we observe. Like you can see, this is the high intense and this is the low intense. So the intensity of this grayscale intensity of the spot which we received, that we monitored through the smartphone, and that actually helped us to quantify the results. Another interesting, which we recently come up with a very good advancement, which I can say, nano-based tools and kit, which we developed to detection of blood samples. How we can detect the blood samples? Like if you are getting trace evidences, and if you want to differentiate between the body fluids, whether it is a saliva, whether it is a blood, or whether it is a semen sample, how we can differentiate? So recently we found with a very interesting results is that if we checked dilution, 1,000 dilutions of blood, and we found that the spot here and that spot indicate around 1-200 dilutions of blood, we found that one spot here, and then we can confirm it that sample, the blood is present in those samples. So sensitivity estimation of also different dilution of blood sample, which we did, and we found very good result. This is some lateral flow based assays which we have developed. And the advantage of this is this technology is that this is the fresh blood, and we took the blood from 30th day, and we found that till 30th, almost 20th day, we are getting good results. So like if you are putting the sample for a long time and that blood remains on that surface for a long time, you know, can also detect, right? So the advantage of it is that the sensitivity is very high. It is very handheld, portable system, user friendly. 10 to 15 minutes we can do this analysis, and less than 200 rupees of cost is there. So that patent is already, we have filed on into this, and this can help to detect the blood on the crime scene. So that is, can also helpful. Other forensic application we can see in this, using this chemistry, is that DNA extractions, a lot of process when we do the DNA extractions from collection of evidences, and then extraction, multiplex PCR amplification, and then finally we'll get authentication report. But here we come up with some interesting studies, that isolation of PCR ready extraction. So we use copper nanoparticle here, and first we do the cell lysis, copper nanoparticle extract those DNA, binding and elution all happens together, and we can get PCR ready DNA. And that study done by my one of the co-workers, and they took control DNA, blood and bone, and they are very good results. They got extraction of DNA for using copper nanoparticle, and they are getting good bands. So that also indicate that we can reduce a lot of efforts of the extraction of those DNAs. Fingerprint also, there's a one area where we can use this forensic chemistry, and where the nanochemistry can be used for enhancement of the fingerprint. A lot of people are working in this direction these days, and that work also we have published in Egyptian Journal of Forensic Science 2018. So here also you can use nanoparticle for fluorescence and colorimetric based detection of lateral fingerprint. These are the work is published recently, one of the group where they've carboxyl functionalized selenium nanoparticle they've used for enhancement of the fingerprint. This is the nanocurcumin, because previously nanocurcumin we have used for the explosive detection. Here we use nanocurcumin for fingerprint enhancement. So this is also area where we can explore the nanoparticles. So where are the opportunities? I would say a lot of opportunity in the forensic chemical science. Development of cost-effective portable kits based on electrochemical sensors. Electrochemical sensor is not much explored for detection of narcotic drugs, for physiological fluids, not only drugs, but a lot of adulteration also you can monitor. Toxicity also can be monitored. Manufacturing of mobile-based narcotic drugs and this psychotropic substances also can be done. mobile based small smart sensors, detection of adulteration is also possible. Of course, GSR analysis using portable kits, there is the area where you can explore. If you look at the biological side, where the chemistry can be intervened, nanochemistry can be intervened, on spot identification of biological food, fluids, age estimation, development of kit for age estimations of biological fluid, we can do rapid DNA testing kit, we can make. So, like, if you want to eliminate the instrumentation part and the same as instrumentation part work, and if you want those same sort of kit, and if we need those same sort of behavior and accuracy, we can also develop portable system which can help to deliver, you know, the same characteristic and the same property of those machines can be for the detection of forensic specimen. So this is what my final thought is, that there is an unmet need in the forensic world. Where can we make a robust a point of need system where we can identify, not only just identify, analyze and evaluation data on the crime scene. So a lot of things, like we can save minimum 40 to 50% of time, and that can also assist in a fair criminal justice if we can done the analysis at rapidly at a point of need. So this is just the work which I explained, that is, I would say, still in a beginning stage. I want that all forensic enthusiastic students take it ahead, and this is the very interesting area where a lot of intervention is required. We can make very portable nano devices and can be helpful to, you know, to detect those forensic specimens, whether it is a body fluid, whether it is a GSR, whether it is explosives, whether illicit drugs. So can be helpful, because crimes are rapidly increasing and there are various ways. So it is very important to detect all the stress evidences, you know, very rapidly. And this is the book which we have published recently, Forensic Nanotechnology as a Future Armor. That was recommended by a very influential scientist, Professor Henry C. Lee, and our, you know, in, like distinguished professors, Professor P. K. Chattopadhyay, and of course another guide who was heading this forensic science department at Gujarat University. So this is the book, because we published this book to sensitize all forensic students. This is the area where you can work. Not many people are interested to go in this field right now, but this has the potential. Nanotechnology has the potential to make such sort of devices and instruments, and the machines can be helpful for the detection of trace evidences. So thank you so much for kind attention, and thank you so much for giving me opportunity.